Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to be here alongside the Health Minister, Brad Hazzard, the Aboriginal Affairs Minister, Ben Franklin. We're also joined today by the Chief Health Officer, Dr. Kerry Chant, Deputy Secretary of New South Wales Health, Susan Pearce, and many nurses, who graduate nurses and midwives who have started last month as part of our significant investment in New South Wales Health across our state. And Emma Purser-Hanson,
is that right?
Yes, it is.
Emma Purser-Hanson will be speaking as well in terms of her experience and many of the nurses who will be starting at this most important time for our state. We're also joined by players for the All-Star game on Saturday evening, where we'll be announcing today a major booster campaign. We've already sold 25,000 tickets to the game on Saturday night, a very important game, which obviously Ben Franklin will speak to as well in our rugby league calendar and the importance for our First Nations people here in our state and across our country. But today we're announcing and introducing some of our graduate nurses and midwives. We've invested, there'll be 2,800 starting. Around one third of those will be located in regional and remote New South Wales. And that's incredibly important at this time as we move through, that the state continues its substantial investment in healthcare across the state. And I want to thank our nurse and midwife graduates because they are starting at a very important time. They are the heroes on the front line throughout the last 2 years of this pandemic. There can be no more important job right now than our frontline health workers. So I want to thank our graduates, and I want to continue to thank our health workers, our nurses, our doctors, our allied health professionals right across the state, who for 2 years have worked day and night to keep our people safe, to give them love and care. As the Health Minister was just saying, when you go into a hospital, what do you always remember is the great care and love that is given to you by our nurses. And it's great to see today the enthusiasm, the excitement of our nurse graduates who have started last month in many hospitals, particularly across Western Sydney, which the Health Minister will speak to. In addition to that, I want to announce today that we've hit 50% of our booster shots for those who are eligible across our state. We want to continue to ask people to come forward and get boosted. We're announcing a campaign today that at this game here on Saturday night, between 4 and 8, we'll have a booster clinic set up for people to walk through. If you're eligible for a booster shot, if it's been 3 months since your second dose vaccination, or alternatively, 4 to 6 weeks since you've had COVID, please come forward and get your booster shot. We'll also be providing over the next month, every weekend, walk-in appointments at any of our 40 centres. So I know that everybody has made a significant effort over the last 2 years. Significant efforts, major sacrifices, but that has all paid off. We were in a very strong position here in our state. We're seeing hospitalisations and ICUs fall. And that's because of the effort that every one of you has made in coming forward and getting vaccinated. And now we just need to ensure that that effort continues in respect of boosters. The evidence is clear, the facts are undisputed, and that is that boosters save lives. They reduce hospitalisations and ICU presentations. So we are providing substantial opportunities with our 40 clinics across New South Wales, provide that opportunity to come forward and receive a booster shot. And obviously as well, you can make those appointments to your GP and your pharmacist, but we have to keep this sustained effort going. I want to thank everybody for the efforts they've made, particularly over the last 2 years, but we've just got to keep going and move through over this next period of time. We know that boosters keep you, your friends and your family safe. The final point I'd make today, there's obviously a number of speakers. The final point is in relation to the changes that Minister Hazzard will speak to in respect to visitations for patients in our hospitals across the state. We know that there's been many heartbreaking stories. It's always a fine balance. We have to be cautious given the high risk setting of our hospitals. But ultimately as well, we want to make sure that compassion is the major focus as we move through. And we want, in those circumstances where we have patients at the end of life, that their carers, their loved ones are there for those obviously very special moments. I want to thank the Health Minister, but particularly the health teams, because we know our health teams across our state have been under stress. Everyone has always wanted to do what is right. is always a fine balance. We have to balance compassion with caution in what is a high-risk setting. We want to make sure that people are protected in our hospital system, but ultimately as well, we need to have the compassion for people right across our state. And I think learning from some of those heartbreaking stories and listening to those stories over the course of the last few days, I appreciate the change and the direction that and the new guidelines that have been issued by the Health Minister today. And I know that will make a real difference to provide support for those people who are coming to the end of life, ensuring that they have their friends, their carers and their family around them. I'm now going to pass to Minister Hazzard, speak in a bit more detail in relation to the booster shot campaign. Our wonderful nurses that are just commenced working in our hospitals right across our state. Then Dr. Kerry Chant will give a public health update. Susan Pearce will provide an update in relation to the health system here in New South Wales. And then we'll hear from Minister Franklin in relation to the importance of this game and the importance of the booster shot campaign right across our state. And then Emma will speak as well in relation to the excitement that she has in commencing in our health system here in New South Wales. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Look, it's a privilege to be here with all of the nurses who have come on to work just in the last few weeks here in New South Wales. There are 2,800 incredible new nurses and midwives who've just started work in our hospitals across the state, 130 hospitals. Of those 2,800, there is about 1,200. So between 33% to 40% of all of those staff are going to work in our regions. So every part of the state is going to have excited and well-trained new nurses to do what nurses do so well, and that is to care for us no matter where we are in the public health system across New South Wales. We're very lucky this morning to have a representative of a group of them, and these young people have all finished their training. They've all trained at universities including Notre Dame, Charles Sturt, Western Sydney University and Sydney University. And this group are going, they've just been talking to me, and they're all heading off to local hospitals, so Mount Druitt, Blacktown, Westmead. And Emma Persa Hansen, one of the nurses, will speak on behalf of the nurses at the end of this press conference, just to tell us a little bit about what they're going to do and what they're feeling today. It is a time, I think, to thank nurses across the state. We have obviously lived now through 2 years and 1 month of this COVID pandemic, and nurses have been at the front line. They've been looking after us. They've taken the stress and the pressure that has kept us all safe. So on behalf of the government and the broader community, I thank all nurses and all medical practitioners, all doctors, all allied health staff, the cleaners, everybody who's worked so hard to keep us safe during this last 2 years and 1 month. I also just want to acknowledge that the boosters are still the single biggest issue for us at the present time. If we have 95% of people basically close to double dosed, and we've got closing in on 50% of people who are boosted, it still leaves around about 45% of people who haven't or had their booster. So what we do know is that boosters reduce the likelihood of transmission to you or to others if you do happen to get it. They reduce the severity of the illness, and they reduce the likelihood that you'll end up in intensive care. And of course, sadly, some people have died and will continue to die from this terrible pandemic. So it reduces the chances of you actually dying. Please go and get your boosters. Minister Franklin will say a few words about Aboriginal residents in New South Wales, but I would like to just say thank you to so many of the Aboriginal community for going out and getting vaccinated. Overall, it's in the mid-80% now of people who have been vaccinated, but of course we do have some pockets, some communities where social media is still putting people off, Aboriginal people and non-Aboriginal people, from having the boosters. Can I just tell you, ignore the social media, it is next to useless. Listen to the science, go and get boosted. It will save your life and probably save family members' lives as well. Just do it, get boosted. Hospital visitations, obviously during the course of this ever-changing pandemic, there have been ever-changing rules and guidance for visitors to hospitals. And it has been challenging. In many cases, I've dealt personally with people who have had family members who are palliative or passing away, and it has been really quite horrible that there have had to be limitations on visitors into hospitals, because obviously the Balancing Act is trying to make sure that we do give access, but also to loved ones, but also make sure that the broader hospital patients are actually kept safe. As we've moved into this stage though of Omicron, there has been a review going on now for the last 2 or 3 weeks. There have been some changes actually in the last 2 or 3 weeks already, but new guidance was completed yesterday by Health. They worked with a number of different groups, including representative patient groups and medical groups, to agree on a set of guidelines. And those guidelines are being distributed today to the entire health system. But I would say this, first and foremost, as I've stressed to the health system, and I'm sure the nurses and doctors and nurses know this, but sometimes it's a little difficult, care and compassion should always be the overriding guide. But of course, that care and compassion, it has to extend to the immediate patient who a visitor wants to see, but also care and compassion to the broader hospital community to keep them safe. So there's a balancing act here, but I'm satisfied that the new guidelines being issued today to the 400 health facilities and 170,000 health staff across the state are as good as they can be for this moment. I'm not saying that there might not be further changes along the way, there might have to be. And I also emphasise that in particular areas there might be a higher rate of transmission of COVID, and in those areas hospital staff, the clinicians, the doctors and the nurses will have to apply their professional judgment to those particular issues. So it will vary on some occasions, in some areas. But overall, there's very clear guidelines now that, for example, if there's somebody who is sadly at the end of their life or in palliative care, that everything should be done to try and ensure that those individuals do have their family members, their friends able to see them. And of course, women giving birth, women going through that amazing process of new life will certainly be able to have their partners with them. But again, those are issues which each hospital will work through. The final comment I just want to make more broadly is that the health system is standing up again to this pandemic. It continues to hold fast in terms of making sure that our hospitals are there for patients and caring for patients. But I am absolutely delighted to be able to tell you that only a few weeks ago we had 6,300 staff furloughed. They were either having COVID, that is suffering from COVID, or they were close contacts. The latest advice I've had is that now those numbers have dropped to just over 2,000, about 2,200 as at today. So we certainly are seeing a little less pressure on our health system, and that's to be something to be very thankful for, and I am very thankful for it. At the end of the various presentations today, we'll hear from Emma Purser-Hansen, who is one of the new young nurses that is representative of the 2,800 nurses. And as she just said to me, there's a lot of excitement. I think the expression was, hell yeah. She's very excited, and they're all very excited. So hopefully she'll be able to give us a little insight into how they're all feeling as they've started their first few weeks in the job. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Minister and Premier. It is actually pleasing to see the case numbers come down in our hospital system. We've got 1,795 people in hospital, including 121 people in ICU, of whom 55 are ventilated. And we're hoping to see those numbers come down further over coming days to weeks. In terms of our positive tests, we've had 10,130 positive tests returned, including 5,824 positive rapid antigen tests and 4,306 positive PCR tests. The PCR tests, the 4,306 positive PCR tests, were returned from 32,167 PCR tests. Can I thank the community for continuing to engage with both rapid antigen testing and also PCR testing. Getting tested if you've got symptoms or if you're a household contact is one of the key strategies in preventing onward transmission. So thank you, and we thank everyone who is adhering to that guidance about isolating in the household and also isolating if you're a case. Sadly, we've got reporting the death of 24 people with COVID-19, 15 men and 9 women. Of the 24 people who died, one person was in their 40s, one person was in their 60s, 5 people were in their 70s, 9 people were in their 80s, 7 people were in their 90s, and one person was aged over 100 years. 8 people had received 3 doses of COVID vaccine, 9 people had received 2 doses, and 7 people were not vaccinated. And as you're aware, we'll give the update tomorrow in relation to deaths overall and some sense of the underlying conditions that have contributed to those deaths, and also expand on the vaccination status, particularly for those younger deaths, so that we convey that to the community. But my key message is to echo everything the Premier and the Minister has said in relation to the importance of booster. So there is no doubt that the majority of people need 3 doses to be up to date with your vaccination, and some will actually be 4. So if you've got those underlying health conditions, transplant patients, you're on immunosuppressive drugs, check with your doctor about what schedule you should be on. So 3 doses are required for most, and 4 doses for some of those people that have got underlying health conditions. Thank you.